I'd like to ask you, Minna, a question at this time. Do you remember, fathers, really this is for fathers, remember that first day when you were going to find out when you were going to be a parent for the very first time? Do you remember the moment when you found that? Can you remember it like it was yesterday? How about you wives? Can you remember the moment that your husband asked you to marry them? Do you remember where you were and the way everything was? And how special that moment is, it was yesterday. There are things in our lives that are continually burned in our memories that we remember and hold on to. This last week, as we celebrated the 14th, actually remembered the 14th anniversary of 9/11. It is one of those days in my life that I will never forget. We have this tendency to remember the worst and the best days of our lives. And those were one of the 9/11 was one of the worst days of my life, as I remember going to the office that day. It was a beautiful day here in Iowa. Walking into the office and beginning my work when I got a telephone call from Janet, which is unusual, to the school nurse there as well. And it was her telling me, get to a television right now. Something terrible has happened in New York City. And basically they just hang up. And so I had to go across the street to our home, to the parsonage, and turn on the TV in time to see the first plane that had gone through the World Trade Center. And then after a few moments, after watching, and as they were speculating that it was a pilot's error or something that caused that, when the second plane hit the other tower. And then our world changed dramatically. It wasn't much longer than that the high school principal had given me a call and said, Steve, we need you. We need you right now. Just come and walk through the halls. And what a day it was as I walked through the halls of this high school and junior high, as we could hear the concern, the fear, parents coming and picking their kids up early and demanding that they come home with that because we had no idea what and where and what was going to happen again. Our world was changed. It was a defining moment that we will never forget. This morning, as we look at the scriptures this morning, we're going to take a moment to look at one of those defining moments in Christ's life. But mostly the defining moment in the disciples' life. It is a pinnacle moment in the Gospel of Mark as Jesus begins to turn his eyes towards Jerusalem. It is in this story that we discover that there is Caesarea Philippi. And it is a defining moment for them as Jesus asks them a very important question. Jesus went on with his disciples to the village of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? And they answered him, John the Baptist and others, Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets. And Jesus asked them, but who do you say I am? Peter answered him, you are the Messiah. And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering. He'd be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Jesus said all this quite openly. Peter then realized, took him aside, and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on the divine things, but on human things. And then he called the crowd to come together with his disciples. And Jesus said to them, if anyone wants to become my follower, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake, for the sake of the gospel, will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in glory in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Amen. What I'd like for you to understand is as you listen to those words, we have it opening up with the village of Caesarea Philippi. It's not on the tours. I've never been there when we've gone to the Holy Land because it's up at the base of Mount Hebron, Mount Hermon, and it is up on the border of Syria. It's not a place where they take you on the tour because you are so close to Syria where we know there's a lot of war and the refugees are seeking to find a way out. But there in Caesarea Philippi has been a long-standing place of worship for pagan gods. There we see the example of the Romans who was the son of Herod, set up a temple for Caesar. A wide, beautiful temple that sat up on a hill high above everything so that all could see, so that those who would come and to honor Caesar, for Caesar was one of those emperors who called himself God. So there we have the presence of the Romans and their belief that their emperors were like God. Also in the midst of that was also the Greeks, their Greeks temple, which was the temple of Pan. The Pan you probably are familiar with. He was the god who was half human and half goat. And he played the flutes, and he was one that oftentimes was mischievous in his way. But there the Greeks would offer sacrifices to Pan, sometimes at the time of spring, offering a newborn child as a sacrifice in order that they would have a fertile spring. And there also was the temple that the Phoenicians had built to their god Baal. Baal we get familiar with in the Old Testament. But Baal was not what a kind or loving god. And so it was a god that required great, great offerings brought to their temple. And in the midst of that are the gates of hell. Literally, what is called the gates of hell is a cave that looks as if there is no bottom. Believe that it goes directly to Hades. And there they will find that the other world and the spirits of the devil. So there's a place as the disciples are walking with Jesus, is a place that you begin to wonder if Jesus chose this very place to be able to ask this important question. Who do you say that who do they say that I am? Out of the blue, and I can imagine the disciples pausing for a minute. Some of them, their hearts beating to the point that they could feel their heart shuddering as they begin to wonder, what is the answer he wants? He's afraid to answer, but then Peter, who is the young fisherman, who is one who is always like a bull in a china closet, blurts out right away, you are the Messiah. You are the Messiah. Now, there are some people who believe that Jesus has two names, Jesus Christ. I hear that especially when somebody inserts their thumb with a hammer or something like that. But Christ is not really the last name of Jesus. It is a word that offers some indication of who he is. In Greek, it means the Christ, which means the anointed one. One who was chosen by God. And in Hebrews, that word also is translated into meaning Messiah. That's why Peter answered, you are the Messiah. And so they began to celebrate as they realized that they were in the midst of the Messiah, the one who had come to save them, the one who was going to lead them. We have to realize that the Jewish people were anticipating a superhuman a superhuman being who would come and gather all of the children of Israel together in Israel from all around the world to come and to defeat, at that time, the Romans, but any of the Gentiles that were putting the Israelites under the thumb so that they would be raised up in power and prosperity and peace. That is who Messiah had been told by for centuries and generations. But here, the disciples were in full presence of the Messiah that was to come. They had seen Jesus do the miracles, the feeding of the 5,000, the healing of the blind, and right before their very eyes, but here they had it confirmed that indeed Jesus was the one who was anointed and sent by God to be the Messiah, the Savior. In a place where people worship pagan gods. There are those scholars who believe that Jesus chose this very place as he stood among all those places where others gone to worship the pagan gods to say, hey, I am the one. I am the Messiah. I'm the anointed one. And here I am. Follow me. There, amongst all of the temples, they fell on the one who was there to be their Messiah. You know, I've never been to Caesarea Philippi, but I feel like I visit it every time I go to Iowa City. You see, as I get off the interstate and I pull up to go to the university hospitals, I go by these, through this valley of the shadow of death, and go by these great temples, you know. Harbor Hawkeye Auditorium is on the left. And over on the right is this giant stadium called Kinnick. Kinnickiki. We do have our temples in a sense. And that's kind of the setting in which the disciples were gathered. Those places where people gathered to worship and to make sacrifices. And so Jesus then went on to make this point that is different. See, all of those gods demanded some kind of sacrifice. From grain offerings to some who were demanding the life of a newborn baby. And Jesus then offers to them this. You see, the Son of Man, is another term that they use that comes from the Old Testament. The Messiah will come. He will be rejected by the chief priests, by the scribes. He will be rejected and punished and be put to death. But on the third day, he shall rise again. What we have here is a God who is not demanding a sacrifice, but a God who is offering his Son to be the sacrifice for us and for the world. You see, our faith, our Christian faith, is based on the cross. It is that dividing line among those who are Christians. That dividing line, much like this story, is the dividing line as Jesus begins his step and walk towards Jerusalem. That as we look upon the cross, there are those who see that as just a pretty ornament that they wear on Sunday morning as something that's maybe beautiful, but they forget what it signifies. That their God sacrificed his life for them. And for those of us as Christians, we see that as the important part of our faith. That is upon that faith, our faith is different than any other faith around the world. That our God offered his Son as a sacrifice so that we might be reconciled to him. That is what separates us from all other religions. All other gods demand some kind of sacrifice, but our God has provided that sacrifice in his Son, Jesus Christ. And that is what is different about our faith and religion. Reconciliation is what we are about. When I have a couple whose marriage is on the rocks and they come in and they want to reconcile, they want to help patch things up, they want to get their lives in order, they want to get back together to the point where they were when they began. And I tell them it's not going to happen without sacrifice. It is not going to happen without sacrifice. You're going to have to give up time that you have spent and this time away from your relationship that has caused you to take your relationship for granted. It's going to require the sacrifice of commitment to one another and to your relationship so that it will continue to grow. Reconciliation requires some sort of sacrifice. And our reconciliation to God is the sacrifice of His Son. As John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son." It is that gospel in just a few words that reminds us that the cross is that crossing line of our faith. It is that moment that we decide for ourselves when we pick up our crosses to follow Him. We choose. We either see Jesus as that historical figure that we see on the History Channel twice a year during Christmas and Easter, and they go on about His life and the people that He touched, or we see Jesus as the Savior of our lives. See, Jesus does not require a sacrifice for us, but what He is requiring from us is that we follow Him, and we pick up our crosses as well and follow Him. That is our choice. See, this place, Caesarea Philippi, is the place that Jesus chose to demonstrate the difference between what Christianity was going to bring to the world and what all other religions was bringing. The others, you have to bring a sacrifice, even the sacrifice to children. But this religion, Christianity, God was going to sacrifice His own Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, as we come before You, let us look upon the cross as a defining line of what it means to be a Christian, to see what You have done for us, and out of that love You have given to us hope. For You indeed rose from the dead. It is in that hope and that promise that we are given new life, so that in our living and our dying, we have our trust in You. Bless us, Lord. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.